we could be anywhere.
Thank you very much again, Mr. Fernandez, to be here this morning for taking a few questions. I would like to invite the next panel to join us on stage, please, Lorena. And I will try to guide you through the agenda of today and explain the reasoning behind every single panel. And we wanted to start this morning with a political and macroeconomic note and give you the general context of the European reform progress and also give a macroeconomic picture. And during the entire day, we would like to understand what is the impact on the covered bond market, what is the impact on the housing market, and on the real life or the real economy of the European continent, but also at global level, and understand what does it mean practically, this set of reform for the covered bond market. While we are speaking this morning, in Strasbourg, Mr. Juncker is having a speech, is giving a speech on the state of the Union. Europe is facing a very challenging time, but we are building the Union, and the set of reform are impacting, or key topic for the covered bond industry is what does it mean harmonization and how every single country has to implement harmonization in their country. And here there is a role to be played and to be proactive from the industry. I would like to recall that this is a plenary meeting, so we have to discuss what's next, what we have to do, what is our role, how we have to move forward. And in this context, we wanted to ask the Spanish community to discuss exactly what are the opportunities, what are the challenges in this debate in Europe, and how we can implement harmonization in the covered bond space. I would like to thank Lorena for coordinating this panel and for the coordinating our hospitality here in Spain. And allow me to mention, we are here in the Cosmo Caixa, and I would like to underline the role of the banking sector in building the future and the science and the long-term investment for a country. And here, being in the Cosmo Caixa, where you can see is the unique science museum in Barcelona, is exactly the role of the banking sectors in financing long-term investment. This is a key discussion in the Capital Markets Union and is a crucial point to be discussed in this forum today. Thank you very much, Lorena.
Good morning to everyone and welcome to our country and to this beautiful city of Barcelona. I hope you enjoy your stay here, despite we have a very full agenda focused on covered bonds, but if you can take your time to go out and enjoy the city. Okay, so I hope this day and this panel will be very interesting for you. For me, it's an honor to be the moderator of this first panel, which is devoted to legislative developments in securitization and covered bonds in Spain. And I hope that in these 40 minutes or half an hour that we have ahead, all your main questions that you have about the future of cédulas and securitization can be answered. As you may know, last year, the Spanish authorities launched a public hearing on the potential improvement of the legal framework of cédulas hipotecarias, and with the objective of gathering the opinion of stakeholders about the different areas or measures that were included in this document. The Spanish Mortgage Association, which represents the Spanish issuers, also sent their views on the key issues after reaching a consensus among our members. On the other hand, this year, in April, it was enacted a new law that includes a new legal framework for securitization in Spain. So to talk about all these measures approved and the future improvement of our cédulas, we have here the following panelists. On my left side, we have here Alberto Martín del Campo, which is the Deputy Director for Regulation and Financial Policy of our Spanish Treasury. Then is Agustín Martín, which is the Head of European Credit Research of BBVA. Also, Juan Pablo Soriano, which is the Managing Director at Moody's Investor Service, and Alex Valencia, which is the Head of the Asset Liquidity Management and Funded at CaixaBank. So, first of all, I would like to pass the floor to Alberto whose department is responsible of financial policy here in Spain. So, Alberto, it would be really interesting to know the work you have done on securitization during the last year, and also the future, how is the current state play of the legal, of the improvement of the legal framework of cedulas. So.
Thank you very much, Lorena. And thank you, the ECBC, for inviting me to this this panel. First of all, well, as Lorena said, we launched a public hearing in October 2014 regarding the possible improvements of the regulation of covered bonds in Spain. Our inspiration was the EBA report. The moment was that the EBA was to approve a report on covered bonds that was derived from the CRR. So we decided to make a reflection with you, with the industry, on the way forward to adapt the regulation of the covered bonds in Spain with an idea in mind that is the market for cédulas hipotecarias, the most important covered bond in Spain, had worked rather well. So any reform should be very should be a fine tuning, should be very should be made very carefully. So we launched this public hearing, as I said. We received a high degree of participation. I would say that around 23 different institutions participated, or associations participated, in the public hearing, giving very, very interesting comments on the question we posed. And I'm going to resume a little bit just to give a focus on the discussion. On the main areas that were included in this report. Well, before that, our idea is to pass a law to include the results of this public hearing. Unfortunately, I cannot give you for the moment a timetable because, well, it is a question of political time. At the end of this year, we will have elections, and I can imagine that after the elections, we will begin preparing this new legislation with the results of the public hearing, if the government so considers. From my department, what I can say is that my intention to encourage this reform, because I think that the results are very valuable, so we should take profit of it. So just to briefly sum up, the main issues we talked about discussed in the public hearing was how to reduce the asset encumbrance, the possibility of segregation of the assets after bankruptcy, if there should be a revaluation of assets, and what is the timing for this revaluation, the possible modification of the eligible assets, the possibility of implementing liquidity rules, transparency rules, and the asset pool monitor. Regarding the asset encumbrance, I would say that as a result, I saw there was more or less a consensus on a reduction of the asset encumbrance was needed. But there are big question marks regarding this reduction, because there is also a consensus on that the level of over-collateralization should be minimum, not a maximum. We pose this question also. There are also very big question marks in the sense that how there is a complex play between these two kinds of assets that should be managed, and also there are transition there are some important issues on the transitional questions on the reduction of the asset encumbrance. Regarding the segregation, it is clear from the industry it should not be a complex measure. And in most cases, the industry reveals a preference for having the assets on the balance. Regarding the revaluation, although a certain level of revaluation it is considered to be needed, there are big question marks on how to be done, and there is no consensus of if there should be used indexes. The only consensus is that the provision should not be taken into account when valuing the LTV. The eligible asset, one of the most important questions for us was the possibility of issuing covered bonds with a collateral of SME loans. We have received the from the industry that it is not very clear that this could be possible or feasible given the heterogeneity of the loans of this kind of loans. And on liquidity, most of the industry is in favor, apparently, to have some kind of liquidity management system, but there is no consensus of this liquidity management system should be a liquidity buffer. More or less, everybody is in favor of transparency rules, but the stress test, if implemented, should be only informative. And finally, there is also a consensus of the importance of the asset pool monitor. But there is also a big question mark on who should be and what kind of rules of conflict of interest should be implemented. Well, this is a general picture of the results that the results of the public hearing that will be used in the next text that we will produce in the incoming months. And just to end my intervention, I only wanted to add some brief explanation on the securitization reforms that we introduced in the law of encouraging financing for corporations. They can be resumed in one phrase, that is, give more flexibility to securitization. There would be more trading possibilities for a private securitization. Now they have to be traded in regulated markets. They will be able to be traded in multilateral trading facilities. There is also more flexibility for closed securitization funds to select assets. More time for these funds to select the assets, and more possibilities for giving collateral for these securitization funds. All in all, as I said, it's a little bit more flexibility. In exchange, we asked for a more capital and transparency requirement for management companies of securitization funds. Well, and that is all that I wanted to introduce in my intervention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alberto. So I will start ask our panelists about some of the measures or areas that Alberto had mentioned and are in relation with the public hearing. First, started by the reduction of asset encumbrance, the possibility of a reduction of the OC, of the high OC that have Spanish cédulas, it seemed to be a controversial aspect of the document, despite other enhancements that were included because of the reduction of the credit quality. I think Moody's in his evaluation of the proposals expressed some fears about the cut in the OC. Juan Pablo, I don't see you. What's your opinion about it? Can you explain us a little bit more?
Yeah, thank you, Lorena. I think if we are going to express an opinion, it needs to be twofold, contemplating both sides of the equation. No? On one side, I mean, we consider credit positive all the measures that the Spanish Treasury is proposing to try to align the Spanish legal framework with the one proposed by European banking authorities. No? All the asset quality requirements, property value updates, liquidity matching principles, more clarification about the bankruptcy of the covered pool are clearly credit positive, no? On the other side, I mean, it's clear that one of the purposes of this proposal legislation is basically to reduce asset encumbrance, to basically, you know, to increase the recovery for senior unsecured, and basically at the end of the day to reduce over-collateralization. As you know, in Spain, you are backed up by the whole mortgage book instead of other countries where you have an earmark, you know, mortgage or pool backing up your cover bonds, no? So for us, I mean, if you ask a question, a simple investor, what is your opinion? The investor will say, well, it's credit negative. If you are going to reduce OC, this will be credit negative for us, no? And for a rating agency point of view, we'll see. It depends. It depends of how much OC is going to be reduced and also how you are going to apply this reduction. Are you going to apply a retroactive character to this reduction? How this is going to be implemented? The positive thing about the Spanish pools is basically, I mean, if you take in consideration the weighted average excess OC that you have in the Spanish pools are well above other European framework. Basically, in average, is around like 85%. So basically, 85% of OC that is not necessary to maintain the current rating. So you have, the positive thing is basically that you have room for maneuver in order to reduce OC in the Spanish pools without the rating being affected.
Thank you, Juan Pablo. You mentioned it's very important to know about the transitional period of this reduction. Agustin, do you share the Moody's views? In your opinion, what other measures could neutralize the negative effects of a reduction of OC?
Yes, definitely. I think that, you know, this measure of reduction of OC will be accompanied by other lessee credit enhancement measures, particularly the LTV updates one, even potentially, although it will be discussed, moving from a hard LTV eligibility criteria to a soft LTV one. Having said that, it's true that, you know, as a research analyst, I think that the Spanish covenant framework should move more in line where the rest of European frameworks are. And we all know that the Spanish framework is the only one where two different OC ratios are defined, the eligible one, which is the 25% mandatory, which limits the issuance of cover bonds, and the total OC, which is theoretically the one which matters for recovery purposes. Taking into account that we are in a BRRD scenario, that we are moving to a scenario where resolution of banks would be clearly resolution and not liquidation, of course, will be the most dominant scenario in the future. I think that is not longer commensurate to keep talking about two OC ratios from my point of view, and if, as it's intended by the Treasury, this revamp of the Spanish Cedulas framework is accompanied by LTV update methodology, added by the inclusion of covered pool asset monitor, I think that the investors should easily understand that it is not longer commensurate to keep defining two different OC ratios. That on the one hand, total OC ratios, I think, is not really the most important rating driver by agencies. They have been much more focused in recent years in liquidity mitigant and asset liability mismatches. So definitely, in a comprehensive review of the framework, I do support the view that we should end the total OC concept and moving towards, like the rest of frameworks of covered bonds, a unique definition of eligible OC. We can discuss later if it's the 25% limit could be even watered down a bit because it's way too high in relation with the other European frameworks. But definitely, we would support removing the total OC concept.
Thank you, Agustin. Another of the areas that was tackled in the document was liquidity. And as the EBA suggested in its document on recommendation or best practices, the document the Spanish authorities launched included three key tools for liquidity: derivatives, substitute assets, and the liquidity buffer. Alex, this question is for you. What is the opinion of the Spanish industry on the use of these instruments, and did you identify any difficulty to implement any of them?
Okay, thank you, Lorena. Well, obviously, liquidity is a very important
important subject, and it's clear that it's not included in the current law, and we have to include that. And if we want to move towards harmonization with other frameworks in Europe, we have to include these types of measures. Liquidity, we can talk about 180 days buffer to cover the redemptions of the covered bonds, also LAM mismatches, these types of things. I think this is very important to include that. But also, what we have seen in the recent years, where the regulation, the banking regulation has improved a lot in terms of liquidity risk. You know that the LCR is binding, coming from October this year. I think that this is very important to adapt all these measures and not to double count assets that are okay for to cover this buffer for covered bonds, but also I think that we have to have these assets unencumbered to take into account into the LCR. I think this is very important to include these features, but to combine the new regulations in banking. No? I think that this is the most difficult thing for to adapt the new regulation and also the proper harmonization of the law.
Thank you, Alex. If somebody wants to add something, just feel free, because I'm just redirecting questions. Sorry. Another of the areas was the revaluation of the mortgage collateral. Here we have two Spanish issuers that have run an update of their mortgage cover pool. So Alex, how was the process to update the whole mortgage pool, and which were the main difficulties in terms of methodology or transparency that were identified and that, of course, should be taken into account in the future legal framework of cédulas?
Well, you know that the reevaluation of the assets that covers the covered bonds was a demand from the investors. I think that for the majority of the rating agencies to try to increase the transparency of these assets, and we, after the strong decline of the real estate market prices in Spain, we decided to update the loan to values of our covered bonds. We disclosed this publicly into the market, and there was no, in Spain there was no previous experience on that. BBVA to follow the same rule and the same path at the more or less the same time, and what we did is to work with the appraisal companies that, as you know, are regulated and followed by the Bank of Spain, and we basically sent all the information of our collateral to these companies, and they tried to evaluate the current value of these assets. So they have in their databases, they have a lot of information regarding the real estate prices in Spain, the current real estate prices, and we send all the information to these companies, and they come back with all the current prices, no? And we update all these values, and we compare with the historical loan to values, and we decided to take out from the cover pool the assets that doesn't have any sufficient LTV to be included with the current LTV's values. And that was the case, and we are updating this process annually, because we don't have any and this is voluntarily completely. We don't have any obliged from the law, but I think it's very important to include this feature into the law, because, as I said, if we want to go toward a normalization, this is a key element. And after the real estate crisis in Spain, we have to update loan to values, and and to give more transparency to the investors and to the stakeholders in general, what's behind this covered bond. And I think this is a key issue.
It has been known for years that one of the main criticism against Spanish covered bonds has been that LTVs were not updated. So whatever you found in rating agencies' performance overviews or in other websites where the original appraisal valuations were during a period during the last 5-6 years where Spanish housing prices has declined roughly 40% in real terms. That created a lot of doubts on investors regarding if, despite of the healthy levels of OC by Spanish issuers, that should be enough to withstand or to guarantee full recovery in a covered pool liquidation scenario. As Alex says, you know, I think definitely updating LTVs is a must. It's something that will be included. We still need to find the right way to do that, but it will be included definitely in the revamp Spanish CEULAS framework in the future. Having said that, what it has been done as of today, and I think that we need to do a bit of criticism of ourselves, has been quite opaque. Only a few issuers has updated LTVs as of today. Even the name, the legal name of this process, desmerecimiento, is a quite long and painful word even to say in Spanish, and it's even harder to try to explain to foreign investors that you now have in Spain some issuers that they have updated or are in the process of updating LTVs and some others where the majority of them that they still use original appraisal valuation. So definitely I think that will be one of the most important advances of the new CEULAS framework to define and mandate some type of LTV update methodology that will bring all issuers to the same level of play. For example, for BBVA, and I think that roughly for CaixA, the application of the desmerecimiento normative has entailed a reduction of 20-25% of the legal mortgage portfolio in the last couple of years. It's a meaningful one, but bear in mind that we have had a huge reduction of the outstanding volume of Spanish covered bonds in the last couple of years, mostly due to the early amortization of previously retained deals to go to ECB repos. So even according to our estimations, and even if we extrapolate, of course that will depend on the issuer, but if we extrapolate this reduction of the legal mortgage portfolio to the rest of Spanish issuers, all of them will still be comfortably above 25% limit. And it's also possible or potential that this 25% limit will be even lower in a new revamped CEDULAS framework. So it's necessary. It has been, honestly, from my point of view, it has been quite opaque process. Some names have done it, some others do not. So investors need to take a lot of attention regarding if they can trust or not LTVs, but definitely that's the way in the future, and we will see more LTV updates, definitely.
Lorena, I would like to add something. As Agustin mentioned, I mean, regarding the eligible pool, no, what has been the evolution of the eligible pool? I mean, we did an exercise in 2013 to see the evolution of the collateral in the Spanish pools, and we came to the conclusion that taking consideration the house price declines, around like 10% of the collateral that was back in the CEDULAS were in negative equity, no? So with loan to values higher than 10%, that 100%, no? So any kind of effort on value the properties or revaluing the properties will be well appreciated by the investors and by the rating agencies. I think going forward, one of the problems that we are going to face is how to do these kind of revaluations. I mean, because in Spain we have two indices in order that deals with the mortgage, no? It's Índice General de Precios al Consumo and Índice General de Vivienda and Índice de Vivienda. One is provided by the National Statistics of and the other is by the Infrastructure Ministry. So, but we don't have one particular for the commercial assets, and there is nothing in the new proposal that basically that deals with this issue. And the commercial assets represent a very important part of the chunk of the balance sheet of these Spanish financial institutions.
Thank you, Juan Pablo. Another section of the public hearing was devoted to eligible assets. And as you may know, there are many jurisdictions that have imposed regulatory limits on the composition of mixed pools, as Eva also in the document suggested as best practice. So this question is for all of you. What is your opinion to impose regulatory limits on the composition of cédulas pools and, for example, commercial lending, and which effects could imply in our market, in our economy?
I will begin. We have seen a clear trend in Europe and even in the EBA document of best practices that regulators do not like too much mixed cover pools. So what we have seen, for example, in a recently revamped frameworks like the Dutch one, is that they are imposing by issuer maximum amount or relative share of commercial mortgages in the pool. So I, let's say, struggle to see Spanish cover pools in the medium term, of course, moving to the composition they have before the crisis and the transfer of real estate loans to the bad bank, which was roughly on average 60-65% residential mortgages, 30-35% commercial mortgages. Definitely this proportion of commercial mortgages is way higher than the one we have in Europe. Likely, one of the topics under discussion will be to limit somewhat the presence of commercial mortgages in the pool. Of course, I think that we will not reach that levels, and that will entail a secondary problem. If we have a limitation on commercial mortgages, that means that a significant part of them, or at least a part of them, will not be able to be funded by cover bonds or mortgage law cover bonds in the future. So that opens the way to, let's say, potentially thinking about new alternatives of funding SMEs in general and commercial mortgages in particular. But the trend is very clear. I think that a significant number of frameworks, they have just residential mortgages as collateral, or in case they have mixed cover pools, they have a limit on commercial mortgages, and we have to acknowledge that. We will not be back to the 60%, 40% distribution we had before the crisis.
I would like to add, from a rating agency point of view, I mean, we consider this kind of asset quality restrictions positive, no? Because if you think about it, I mean, you rather prefer to have a loan backed up by an 80% loan-to-value better than a loan backed up by 95% loan-to-value in the cover pool. Same that reduction of loans to real estate developers that used to be 20, now they are going to be 10. Or loans to finance the acquisition of properties that has been finished but not sold. There is also a reduction or more clarification of the non-performing loans from asset quality, you know. This is positive for the rating agencies, but I have to add that also the new proposal of the Treasury is also expanding the asset base for cédulas territoriales, because in cédulas territoriales, you realize that right now the assets are loans granted to the state, to the autonomous community, to the public bodies, but now they are adding a new asset class, which is basically the possibility to include the debt issued by these public bodies. No? So it's restriction from one side, but on the other hand, I mean, it's more leeway.
Okay. Changing now to securitization, Juan Pablo, what's your opinion about the new national rules for securitization? It provides more flexibility to manage some credit risk?
In our experience, I mean, I think this is much more flexible. I mean, if you think about it, I mean, they have eliminated the concept of homogeneous pool. So basically, I mean, the originators will be able to create portfolios that satisfy the investor needs. They have eliminated the need that 50% of the fund liabilities of the fund needs to be financed by securities issued by the SPV. Now the SPV could accept the loans provided by institutions that are not credit institutions. Also, they have clarified one very important point in the Spanish securitization, which is basically the liquidation of the fund. In the Spanish legislation, before legislation, that was basically in the case that you have a permanent and a serious and a permanent disequilibrium in the Spanish fund, you will need to liquidate it. And there was some people, I mean, in the market, investors, even the rating agents, we didn't know what is the meaning of a serious imbalance, no? When you have a default on a AAA, when you have a default in a subordinated tranche, and they have clarified that basically in order to liquidate the fund, you need to have 3/4 of the of approval of the note holder syndicate, which is very positive. And finally, I think for me, I mean, in cover bonds, I mean, they have paved the way to open the structured cover bonds in Spain, no? That basically providing the opportunity to the SPVs to basically to guarantee bonds issued by the financial institutions and ring fence part of the balance sheet of the Spanish financial institutions.
Thank you, Juan Pablo. Agustin, do you think there is something in the pipeline, any national change still pending, or now the reactivation of the securitization market is on the hands of or the international body's regulation?
Well, definitely from the Spanish framework of securitizations, I think there is little more to do. It's really advanced and it's in line with what we are seeing in other European jurisdictions. But what we need to revamp securitizations, I'm beginning to think it's a bit of help of God, because we have been waiting for so many years to see some real progress. We shouldn't fool ourselves. We will have the European Commission action plan or measures on securitizations to be published later in the month. They will mostly follow the footsteps of the EBA document, which is a positive development. But everything is not solved, like just by reducing capital risk weights 25% on average for a simple for the STS securitization. There is a lot of questions still need to be discussed, like LCR treatment of securitizations, how securitizations or senior tranches are treated regarding cover bonds. This is still a quite important, relevant, pending issue to be solved there. There is lack of, I would say, willingness by governments to provide some powerful guarantees scheme to mezzanine tranches. So, of course, the development of the Spanish securitization frameworks are okay, are welcome, it's a positive step. But unfortunately, it's not enough. We have Solvency II beginning in 2016. Solvency II is killing all the interest of pension funds and insurance companies to invest in on securitization. That needs to be changed also. So big question is that if the European economy or the Spanish economy can wait an indefinite period of time till securitizations are back, or we should be thinking, as we are thinking already, in different alternatives. As of today, my view is that securitizations will be only used in Spain, particularly for players like UCI, which are brokers, no banking license, no access to cover bond program, and that's mostly all. Maybe we see some traction on consumer unsecured loans, for example, but it's little to see. I struggle to see in the short to medium term a strong Spanish ABS market coming back. From the originator, from the bank's perspective, you have several alternatives. You have cover bonds, you have all the LTRO, TLTRO families. So unfortunately, more is done, and what needs to be done goes beyond, much beyond the boundaries of Spain. It's a alignment of regulators, central banks, etc., etc.
All right. And then to finalize, before giving the floor to the audience, if they want to ask some questions, I would like to ask about the health of our cedulas market. Alex, could you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, well, you know how it's the market. Clearly, we have one thing that it's you know, there's a condition in the market. This is the purchase program from the ECB. From the beginning, from this purchase program, for instance, in our issues, we have seen a clearly reduction of the spreads. There's a strong tightening in the secondary market, but on the other hand, we see that if we ask about this is the real level or not, because it's true that the liquidity on the market is very low, and also because we have seen that in the primary market, the proportion of the ECB in the primary market transactions is increasing above this 30% between 30 or 50% of the transactions. It means that there's a lack of demand coming from, especially from real money investors, that finds that their levels of the current covered bonds are well below the Spanish Treasury, for instance. And also we have seen an increase in new investors, you know, like banks trying to fulfill the LCR buffers. There's a combination of these things. And from the supply side, what we have seen is there's a decrease on the supply due to the fact that the deleveraging process in Spain, but also there's a compensation in the commercial gap. There's not a growth in the funding needs. It means that for the future, for the next months, what we expect is a reduction in supply. You know, there's more redemptions than new issues in the future, and also due to the fact that new regulation, from capital regulation, we have to meet TLAC, MREL, this type of regulation. It means that part of the funding have to be covered by new seniors or lower tier two or additional tier one. No? And all these, you know, these forces drives the market on that sense.
And Juan Pablo, could you tell us briefly about your new anchor point covered bonds and the positive rating actions that taking place in Cedulas during the last months?
In Spain, what we have done is basically we have adopted the European Bank Recovery and Resolution Directive. I mean, we have converted this into law, and the implications for this is basically in Moody's we have changed what is called the covered bond anchor point. It used to be the senior unsecured, but now we have introduced the counterparty risk assessment, which is basically an indication of the probability of going concern of an entity. It's basically it's trying to reflect that what will be the probability of default of the senior obligations of a bank. Because if you think about it, the fact that you have a senior unsecured event, the fact that you have a senior unsecured default, does not mean that you are not going to pay your cover bonds. And that's what we have introduced in Europe. As a result of this, cover bonds which are excluded from bail-in, cover bonds that basically will need, in case of a bank resolution, most likely the bank financial authorities are going to help them in order to pay them the cover bond. I mean, the rating actions that we have taken in Spain is, on average, has been an increase in ratings by an average of 3.3 notches. Also, for those institutions that were at the level of the sovereign ceiling, they have seen a reduction of the OC in approximately 10.5%. And in Moody's terminology, what we have seen is basically an increase in the TPI leeway. So it's basically, in other words, to reduce the volatility of the rating. So basically, if the issue is downgraded, we will see less volatility in the cover bonds in Europe, not only in Spain.
Thank you, Juan Pablo. So the audience want to ask some questions there.
Yeah, can I start with one question on that point of liquidity?
Could be.
Does your model take into account the fact that the LCR conformity, and do you have a different approach for those cover pools that are held by legal entities that have an LCR requirement and those that don't, such as non-bank SPVs?
Not at the moment. I mean, we are not reflecting this in our model right now. I mean, we will need to do that in the future. But Richard, the concrete answer is no.
But I think it's important to include that topic, because I think it's key for the issuers as a banks.
Thank you. I have two questions for Alberto. Alberto, you rightly said the main incentive or the main objective of the reform will be asset encumbrance to basically deal with this in Spain. And in order to do that, you need to segregate in some shape or form the assets from the rest of the balance sheet. There are three basic models. You can segregate it over a register, which you could call the German model. Secondly, you can transfer the assets to another legal entity and have that entity issue the bonds, like in France or in Ireland. And thirdly, you have a guarantee structure as we know it from the UK and Italy and the Netherlands. First of all, when gathering the feedback on the query that you made last year, what was the main, was a bias that you could observe, what people would tell you, what they would prefer to see in the new reforms? And also, what is your personal view as Alberto on this topic? And from where I sit, it felt like you had some sympathy for the guarantee model when it was explained by Juan Pablo. That is the first part of the question. Secondly, you may agree very quickly on the status, on the objective, but there's also 150 billion, more than 150 billion euros of outstanding settlers. So the question is, how did you give a thought on how you want to convert from the existing system to the new one? Thank you.
Yes, regarding the asset encumbrance, I would distinguish two things. One, the measures to reduce the asset encumbrance, and the other one, the segregation of assets. As far as we have seen in the public hearing, there is an agreement on the idea of reducing the asset encumbrance. The way forward, I think that some of my colleagues have underlined more or less the idea. The way forward would be to avoid the actual system where the covered bonds are guaranteed by all the assets of the credit institution. And going to a model where only eligible assets will be the guarantee for the credit institution, but without reducing the limit to the issuance limit and the actual levels of collateralization. So this is the way forward that was underlined, I think, in the public hearing. But this doesn't mean we go through to a segregation model. That you know, as you know, segregation model can be ex ante or ex post. In Spain, the system we have is a system of register. You have to register all the loans that are guaranteeing the cover bonds. And I would say that from the point of view of the industry, what we have seen is they are not very pro segregation. Neither ex ante nor ex post. The ex post, I mean, in case of bankruptcy, just to guarantee that there is enough guarantee for the investor in case of bankruptcy. They prefer to keep the assets in the balance of the credit institution. That is what we have seen in the public hearing. Regarding my opinion on this, I would say that I tend to sympathize with the idea of segregation, ex post segregation of the assets. The decision is not taken because I understand that it's very difficult, but I would say that I tend to sympathize with this idea because we believe that it creates a lot of certainty for investors. And we know, above all after, although it is not the same problem, but above all after Banco Madrid, that went through an insolvency procedure, that insolvency procedure can get really, really complex. And if we we have kind of exposed rules facilitating the situation for covered bonds bondholders, I think it would be an interesting idea. But we understand that the solution is complex, how to do this if we use a kind of securitization fund, or how to do it is not really easy. Regarding the transitional period, well, we have the transitional period and measures. Well, we have given some thoughts on this. We have received a lot of inputs on this issue. We have also received the worries from the industry. We understand the worries because it can really have an impact on investors. But I cannot tell you much for the moment because. We don't see a clear way to address this problem. I mean, there are ones who favor more a kind of big bank approach that's going in the less time possible, all the current portfolio should be adapted to the reform, or others that prefer a grandfathering clause. I cannot tell you the position of the Treasury on this because it is still very complex, and I believe that when we start the reform, when we start drafting the reform, we will have to have a lot of contacts with the industry to address this issue, because we understand it's one of the most important of the next law, and we have to discuss it very thoroughly. But for the moment, we don't have a solution.